So, welcome once again. We will begin with a word of prayer. Would like to request anyone in the class to pray to bless this time of studying God's word. So, anyone, just feel free, unmute yourself, and please lead in prayer, please. Okay, who is able to lead?
I will pray, ma'am.
Okay. Yes, Kiran.
Father God, we just come before you. Once again, your throne, Father God. Father God, thanking you for the all days, Father God. Thanking you the weekend. Thanking you the class. Thanking you the family and everything, Father God. Thanking you, Father God. Father God, bless each and every student and also man, Father God. And whatever we are just going to learn, Father God, help us to understand, Father God. Give your wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, Father God, that we can receive and we can apply to our your kingdom work, Father God. Father God, thanking you the moment and time, Father God. Upcoming time, I'm just submitting to your hand. You just take care of every side. Almighty Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Kiran. So we've been going through Gospel. Yeah, Gospel of John. And we are looking at the eyewitness accounts of the life of Jesus. We've seen how he went about doing his miraculous works, manifesting his glory. And, you know, we saw how the works that he did were received by some people, but a lot of people were actually offended by his works. They were offended by his words. And we saw how Jesus was talking to them, trying to convince them. In the last chapter, John chapter 7, we saw how people were trying to give him different names, okay? Trying to assess who he was and then know his identity. But, you know, Jesus was quite firm in saying that he is related to the Father and that he is the Son of God. So we'll continue and see what goes on, because till now, the work of Jesus is becoming very clear. The Jews are getting very angry with him. And in fact, they're waiting for an opportunity to kill him. And in the last chapter, we also saw that when the Jews wanted to get a hold of Jesus, even though, you know, it was possible for them to put him in trial and then proceed to killing Jesus, the time was not perfect, right? So there are many other things that God really wanted to release through the life of Jesus. So Jesus said, my time has not yet come. Like, even if you want to kill me, this is not the moment in which my end is going to occur. So Jesus continuously went on doing his work, and he was very bold about his identity, and he was very bold about his relationship with the Father, and he proceeded with his work. So now we are in John chapter 8, and we'll see what works he does, what claims about himself he makes, because so far we've seen that, you know, he is revealing his identity, and particularly when he talks about his relationship with the Father, you know, he is claiming that he is God, he is deity. So even in John chapter 8, you know, we will see one incident, but that incident leading to questions and the responses of Jesus. You know, Jesus has been claiming so far that he is the Son of God. So here also, boldly, he's going to make some claims. Okay, when we say claim, it's like saying, owning up to something. So if I say that I am the owner of this house, or, you know, I am the heir of this house, I'm making a claim, you know, I'm staking my claim, and I'm saying that this is true. Okay, I believe it, this is true, I own this. So Jesus is going to make some claims, some statements through which he's going to show that he is God, and that, you know, he is in authority. So let's go to John chapter 8 in our notes. You can actually refer to Enduring Word of David Guzik, which I've already posted on our stream page for the online students and for the e-learning students. There is a mention of this in our the document that I've posted about the syllabus. So you can use that as one of the main commentaries, but of course you're free to refer to many other commentaries on the Book of John. So mainly we are looking, some of the insights that I've been sharing so far are from that commentary also. Okay, so you could look at that, or just turn to the chapter, John chapter 8 in the Bible. Okay, so here we saw in John chapter 7 that Jesus was in Jerusalem. Okay, he attended the Feast of Tabernacles when he talked about the Holy Spirit that will be released on the Holy Spirit, which will be poured out on the people, and the Holy Spirit which indwells the believer after the baptism, that it can also flow out like a river, blessing the lives of the people around. So we saw that. Now, where is Jesus? Well, Jesus is in Jerusalem. That's very clear, because he went up for the Feast of Tabernacles. Now, Jesus, he's in that area. He's still in that area, even though it was not safe, because the Jews were slowly plotting to kill him. So it wasn't a very conducive environment, but he stays on in Jerusalem for some more time. And, we know that Jesus was led by the Father, and he wanted to do the works of the Father. So I'm sure that, he knew that there was something more to be done in Jerusalem before he proceeded and, moved off to other places. So let's see. So we see here at the very beginning of John chapter 8 that he went to the Mount of Olives. Now, early in the morning, he came again into the temple, and all the people came to him, and he sat down and taught them. So we see the boldness of Jesus. Jesus would have been attacked by the Jews quite a lot, and yet he's continuing with his teaching, he's continuing with his work of ministry. So what is he doing in the temple? He's spending time with people, he's imparting from the word of God into their lives, he's strengthening them in the faith. So he's doing his work, so shows his attitude of boldness in the midst of opposition. Now, when he is continuing this, we notice that the scribes and Pharisees, scribes and Pharisees are the so-called custodians of the law, because they used to keep the law, and they used to teach the law, they used to propagate the law. So these are the people who felt that they know so much about God's word. So these people, they come, and what they're doing right now is they're bringing a woman who's caught in adultery. And when they bring her to Jesus, they are asking him this question. They said to him, "Teacher, this woman was caught in adultery in the very act. Now, Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what do you say?" This they said, testing him that they might have something of which to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down and wrote on the ground with his finger, as though he did not hear. So now what's happening is part of the plot of catching Jesus was to, trap him. So this was a trap. They bring a woman who was caught in adultery, and based on the law of Moses, they're asking him whether they should go ahead and stone her because she is guilty now. So if Jesus says yes, he is upholding the law of Moses. If Jesus says no, then he's not upholding the law of Moses. So then they can immediately accuse him and say, "Oh, how can you be from God? You have claimed to be from the Father, but you're not upholding the law of Moses." So that was the trick. They wanted to see what Jesus is going to say. Now, Jesus also knew, and it says that a woman who is caught in adultery in the very act. So it's really funny because they brought one person who's engaged in the sin, but the other person is not there. As if, it was only the woman who was engaging in the act of adultery. So it shows us right there that the way the scribes and Pharisees planned this was also something very unusual, because they must have caught the couple and brought the couple to Jesus. Maybe they were married, or it was an act of fornication, we don't know, whatever it was. So the couple should have been brought. But when they bring only the woman, like, Jesus also probably understood that something fishy about this. So we don't know if that woman was kind of, obviously, they are saying that she was caught in the act of adultery, so that is a sin, no doubt. But the way the trap was made for the woman, we are not very clear. Who knows? Maybe one of the scribes or somebody set up this whole situation, and then they wanted to catch only the woman and bring her and accuse her. So Jesus is mindful of the dignity of the woman while he is not condoning the sin. Because if he were to condone the sin, he could have easily said, okay, let her go. It's okay, forget it. But, our God is also a God of justice. He cannot look at sin and shut his eyes and ignore it. God will deal with the sin in the lives of the people. But he is also mindful of the dignity of the individual who's being brought, and he understands that in a way it is very one-sided, the way the accusation is being made. So if he were to say that, yeah, stone her, then we realize that there's no sensitivity in the way he has assessed this this sinful act that has taken place. So on the one hand, he has to uphold the law. On the other hand, he has to be fair in the way he judges the situation. So what is Jesus going to do? Okay, so that was exactly the kind of scene that the leaders wanted to set for Jesus to trap him. So here is Jesus. And you see that when he is told about the situation, he is writing something on the ground. Okay, and a lot of historians, theologians wonder, what was Jesus writing? Apparently some commentaries, they say that he was drawing something on the ground. Now, we don't have clarity on what he wrote on the ground, but he was meddling, he was writing something. It could have been some text that he wrote, or it could have also been, something that he was sketching or drawing on the ground. We are not clear about that, and we don't know what the implication of that would be on this particular matter. But the way he responded, that is quite clear. He responded as if to say that, as if he didn't hear. They're coming so seriously to get a judgment on the matter. But when he is carelessly, when somebody is talking to us and I'm just like reading my Bible, it's as if I'm not listening to them. So that way, Jesus is writing something on the ground. So he is processing it within himself, but he's just appearing like, okay, yeah, tell me, I'm not worried about this, or I'm not disturbed or anxious because of what you all are trying to do. So that is his attitude. Now, when they were continuing to ask him, what he did is he just stood up. So he's speaking to them eye to eye now. For a while, he was not looking eye to eye. Now he's looking eye to eye. He stood up. He raised himself up and said to them. So he is giving them a response on this particular matter. So he says, he who is without sin among you, let him throw a stone at her first. Okay. Now, we as God's people, when we hear the words of Jesus, we are amazed. What a wise way to deal with the situation. We could go back to the way Solomon used to answer the difficult prob you know the problems which would be brought to him, the way Solomon would answer and display the wisdom of God. Even in the life of Jesus, when he is dealing with these difficult circumstances, we are able to see the wisdom of God unfolding. So look at this statement, how beautiful, you know. It's like you have to see which side is the scale going to tilt. Guilty, not guilty. What is it going to be? But Jesus uses a statement and he says, "He who is without sin among you, let him throw a stone at her first." So they are stuck now, because the answer to this question is nobody is without sin. Okay, so obviously they cannot throw a stone because they are all guilty. Okay, now is the woman guilty or not? Now that issue was not addressed by this, because Jesus sort of covered her up. Is she guilty or not guilty? That's not the question anymore. If you are sinless, you take a stone and you throw it at her first. Okay, so what happens? They are trying to trap Jesus. Jesus has trapped them with this one statement. And again, he goes back to the ground and, you know, he's just doing his thing as if, yeah, okay, continue with your arguments. I told you what I need to tell. And this one statement of wisdom will take care of the situation. So now what happens? Those who heard it, they got convicted by their conscience, because they knew that nobody was authorized to throw a stone at her, because anybody, if they did it, you know, the neighbors would look at them and be like, "How can you be such a liar? Everyone has sinned. So nobody is authorized to throw a stone at her and confirm that she is guilty." So then what happens? One by one, okay, they are convicted in their conscience, and each one of them started going out. Okay, so they all left. They all left the scene. Now Jesus was left alone. And here is the sinful woman standing in front of Jesus. Now this is what Jesus tells her. Did Jesus condone her sin? No, he never said you're not guilty. She was caught in the act of adultery, so she's as guilty as the man involved. So Jesus knew that this is sin, and he cannot try to make it better for this woman. So he did not let her go scot-free, for sure. Okay, but what did he do when all the people left the scene? No, he tells her, when all the people left the scene, the woman is standing, Jesus is standing, and again, you know, Jesus raises himself up, meaning he spoke eye to eye to all the men. They left the scene. Now he's speaking to the woman eye to eye, and he's telling her, "Woman, where are those accusers of yours? Has no one condemned you?" So in a way, it's like him preserving her dignity. Okay, so he's dealing with her in a gentle way. Though she's a sinner, he deals with her in a very, very dignified way. So she says, "No one, Lord." And Jesus said to her, "Okay, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." Okay, now we might also wonder, why is it that Jesus didn't take a stone and, you know, stone her? Okay, but then see, the question was not for himself. He didn't say that I will throw the stone if she's guilty, but he had presented it to the people who are watching. So it was not for him to take up a stone and throw it and accuse her. But you notice, he tells her, "Go and sin no more." It's as if to say, you have sinned. Okay, he didn't throw a stone at her, but he acknowledged the sin. And he said, you're not guilt-free. You have sinned. So this is what I want to tell you. You have sinned, but I will not condemn you. Go and sin no more. So Jesus understands that everyone, right, we have to live our lives righteously before God. And what he said, it convicted the people who came to trap Jesus. And here he is speaking a word to this woman. Was she convicted? No, we don't read that, you know, she left or she said, oh yes, Jesus. None of that. We don't read all that. But obviously, you know, his word would have convicted her heart. Now, if this case were assessed and they would have found out that, yeah, she's an adulteress or whatever, you know, whatever situation happened, that sinful situation happened, the woman would have definitely been convicted just like the accusers. Okay, so Jesus dealt very beautifully with the situation. He dealt fairly with the situation, and at the same time, he did not approve of the sin. Okay, and that reveals to us how he was moving about by the wisdom of God in his life, and really, you know, in a setting now. When people are doing the works of God, today you and I, we are doing the works of God, you know, just as he is, we should be in this world. And as we do the works of God, there will be a lot of opposition. There could be people who try to trap us with words. They try to trap us with situations. But look at Jesus. He was bold enough to continue his work. He went back to the temple. He was doing his teaching work and all that because he knew about the times. So, you know, he knew that these people cannot trap him and kill him right now. There is more time available for him to do the ministry. So he was very sensitive about the calendar of the Father. And at the same time, the wisdom of God through his life, where he knew exactly how to deal with a sticky situation. So when we go through sticky situations, you know, we must pray. We must ask God, okay, God, what do we do now? Because if we say this, then we are in trouble. If we say something else, we are in trouble. Okay, but just the right statement, you know, Jesus put forward, and he dealt fairly in every sense. So we too can flow in the wisdom of God. This wisdom comes through the practice of God's word. You know, through our lifetime, we are studying God's word, applying his word. That brings us, you know, to a place of wisdom. We know how to apply the word. We can walk in the fear of God. You know, scripture says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So when we do that, there is wisdom in our lives. And at the same time, you know, we have the anointing of the Holy Spirit. So at times when we don't know what to answer, you know, the Holy Spirit can impart things into us, and suddenly, you know, a word comes out of our mouth and we are only surprised, wow, how did I say that? You know, it could be the working of the Holy Spirit who gives us the right answer for that moment. And Jesus told us, right, that we must not worry, and when we are questioned, particularly when we are questioned. So that's the manner in which Jesus is actually dealing with this situation. So now let's just continue. I'll just drink a little bit of water. I don't know why I'm having a little bit of an issue here. So please give me a moment. Sorry. Yeah, some almost regular throat issues now, but I think it's getting better. So sorry about that, everyone. Okay, so we saw how he dealt with the sticky situation. Now, proceeding forward, what is the scenario that Jesus is in? Excuse me. It's one of opposition. Yeah. So the Pharisees, okay, continue to oppose him. So now they are coming back to Jesus, and they are saying, see, you're talking all these things, but whatever witness you're bearing, till now you're saying that you know the Father, and the Father and you are one, but they say that your witness is not true. Okay, you're bearing witness of yourself and your witness is not true. We are not going to agree that you are from the Father. So here is Jesus' response. So Jesus answers them and he says that even if I bear witness of myself, my witness is true. For I know where I came from and where I'm going. You see, these are all the claims I told you. Now, Jesus is starting to claim that he is God, that he is one with the Father. Okay, he does only what the Father tells him to do and things like that. So he is very clearly expressing to the Pharisees that he is the Son of God, that he is the Messiah. But we talked about the hardness of their hearts, right? We said when they saw the miracles, instead of being amazed about the miracles, their questions were more about, you know, who is this man who healed you? Why is he doing this on the Sabbath day? So hard-heartedness. So they are coming with a hard heart before Jesus. So they are looking at Jesus. You know, Jesus said that if you don't believe me, it's fine. Believe the works. At least believe the works, because they bear witness of me. And now these people, they are saying that, what witness are you bearing? Your witness is false. So Jesus, you know, he is so bold in making the claim. He says, I told you to believe at least the witness of the works. You're not even ready to believe that. So let me tell you, I don't even need a witness. So he says, if I bear witness of myself, meaning I don't need another person or I don't need anything else to help me prove that I am the Son of God. Even if I stand by myself, whoever I am, the person that I am, you know, my witness is true. So he has come to that place where he's very bold before the Jews. And he says, my witness is true. And now he's not mincing words. He's not confusing the people. He's telling them, I know where I came from. So what is he saying? He's saying, I am God. I have come from heaven. And he continues to add to that. And he says, I know where I am going. So the Jews must have understood the point. Here is a man, he's claiming to be God. He's saying, I came from heaven. I'm going back to heaven. I'm the Messiah. But you do not know where I come from and where I'm going. You judge according to the flesh and I judge no one. And yet, if I do judge, my judgment is true, for I am not alone. So he's just claiming that, you know, I'm firm in myself, and who I am, that is witness enough that I am from God. And he says that generally it is said that you need two witnesses, okay, to prove that something is true. That's what the Old Testament says. But Jesus is saying, I by myself, I can give you the confirmation that I am the Messiah. But if you want one more witness, okay, again, it is like we say, right, rocking the boat. Things are very much at peace, but you say something which makes things worse or more difficult. So Jesus is saying over here that verse 18, he says, I am one who bears witness of myself, and the Father who sent me bears witness of me. So you want one more witness, isn't it? Okay, here is the other witness, the Father. Understand how furious the Jews would have been. Okay, they are now very upset. They're like, how dare? First of all, you are claiming that you are the Messiah. And when we are asking you, you know, we are telling you that your witness is false. Now you're saying the other witness is the Father, which is Jehovah God. You know, he is the witness that you are the Messiah. So they were very, very angry. So they ask him the next question. Now, we must understand that in their community, okay, and at their times, to ask a question like, where is your Father? Okay, it was insulting, disrespectful, because that is to kind of doubt whether you are a legitimate child. It's to say that, oh, you're born out of sin or something like that. So it was not a good question to ask anybody. But this is what the leaders, you know, the learned men, Pharisees, scribes, the people against Jesus, they are asking him now. They're very upset with him. So they are asking, where is your father? Okay, so that's a very offensive question which they are asking him. And Jesus answered, he tells them, you know neither me nor my father. If you had known me, you would have known my father also. So Jesus' response is also very firm, authoritative, and it's like he's giving them a rebuttal for the offensive question which they have asked. So they might have expected, what is he going to say? You know, he might say, my father is a carpenter, his name is Joseph. Okay, but also, you know, we know that there were speculations about the birth of Jesus, because the incident, right, when the angel comes to Mary and says, you will now have a child, and give him the name Jesus. Jesus was born of the power of the Holy Spirit. So who is the father? Earthly father? Yes, Joseph was the earthly caretaker of Jesus. But Joseph was not the real father of Jesus. So is Jesus giving the right answer to their question? It sounds like he's trying to offend them, but this is the truth. They asked the question. So he's giving them the truth. He's saying, look, God the Father, he is my father, and you don't even know him. Right? Because if you had known me, or if you are accepting of who I am, you know, you would also know my father, but you are not accepting of me. So why do you even ask this question about my father? So in this way, you know, Jesus spoke, and he just, it's like they are trying to rock Jesus's boat. He is giving them, you know, bang, bang, he's giving them answers. And for a moment, it is taking care of the situation. So they tried to trap him with that adulterous woman. He took care of the situation. Now they asked, who is your father? He took care of the situation. And he is continuing with God's work. Okay, and that is his priority. He's here to do God's work. So he also knows the timing. This is not the time. These people will try to say a lot of things, but they won't be able to get me. So he's continuing his work. So then we read, you know, Jesus, he continued to teach in the temple. He taught in the temple, and nobody was able to lay hands on him because it was not the timing when he must be persecuted. Okay, moving forward. Now, Jesus, okay, he tells them that I'm going away. And you will seek me, and you know, you will die in your sin. Where I go, you cannot come. So he is referring to his redemptive work on the cross, which he's going to do very soon. And he knows that he's going to heaven. Okay, but he also knows the hearts of the people. We know already that many of them, right? Many of them, they didn't believe. Many of them who used to believe left him. So that was the scene. So he is looking at those who don't believe, and he's saying, you will die in your sin. So he is kind of making a connection and saying, look, if you believe, the sin in our lives can be dealt with. The sin can be taken away. Okay, the sin can be cleansed. We can be cleansed of our sin. So again, the claims of Jesus, I said, you know, there are some direct claims where he says, I am the. But in other things, what Jesus does is he basically says that, you know, in an indirect way, or you have to understand what he's saying to recognize the claim. But he is claiming that he is the Messiah. Again, he is saying that, you know, I am going away. Where I go, you cannot come. In indirect ways, he is claiming he is the Messiah. So the Jews said, what does he mean, you know, that he is going away? Is it that he is planning to commit suicide? He's saying, I'm going away. No. So you see, they were listening to Jesus, but they were not understanding, you know, understanding, believing. These are the things that Jesus wants. He just does not want listening. Or listening also is a little more deeper thing. But hearing, you know, hearing means it falls on your ears, And it doesn't make any sense. And that is the kind of audience that Jesus is dealing with here. When he says, I'm going away, look at the question they're asking. Is he going to commit suicide? Because he says, where I go, you cannot come. What is this? So they are lacking understanding. They're lacking that ability to listen. What is the... See, listen is when somebody is talking, they are trying to make a point. That is listening. But what is hearing? But you said you're going away somewhere. You are from beneath. I am from above. You are of this world. I am not of this world. It's a claim. It's not direct, but it is indirect. So he's saying, I'm the Messiah. I'm from heaven. You are from earth, but I'm from heaven. I'm from above. Okay, so let's see how this is going to be processed. Therefore, I said to you that you will die in your sins. For if you do not believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. So unfortunate, right? That even today, there are lots of people, they know about Jesus. They hear about Jesus. They hear the words of Jesus. That is not enough. You know, superficially knowing, Jesus said this, Jesus, this is how he lived his life. He did the miracles. But what is the need? He's saying, look, if you don't believe, you will die in your sins. So is Jesus being hard with the people? Is being harsh with the people? Actually, no. He's being very kind to them because he's trying to pull them to understand that you need salvation. Stop resisting. Stop being hard-hearted. If you don't believe, you know, you need to see that I'm the Messiah. You cannot save yourself from your sin. I will save you from the sin. So you need to believe. So he says, if you do not believe that I am he, you will die in your sin. So in a way, though it comes across as if Jesus is being rude or Jesus is being very stern, see what kind of answers he's giving these people. But it is his compassion. He's trying to show them, why can't you understand? I am the Messiah. Then still they have a hard heart. So what are they saying? After saying so much, who are you? You know, it's like insult after insult. Who is your father? Now, they come to the question about his very identity. They have heard his words. They have seen his works. They know where he comes from. They have heard his claims. They have heard his witness. So much evidence. They are questioning his very identity. And they say, who are you? Insult. Okay. So Jesus is dealing with like very, very severe condemnation and pulling down. So let's see how he deals with it. So Jesus says, just what I have been saying to you from the beginning. So just because you are trying to make me uncomfortable, I'm not going to change what I'm telling you. Same thing. I am that same person. So he's saying that I have many things to say and to judge concerning you, but he who sent me is true. And I speak to the world those things which I have heard from him. Again, you know, he is connecting himself to the Father. And he's saying, I have come from the Father. And, you know, I'm speaking what the Father is telling me to speak. So once again, when he's talking about the Father, they did not understand that he spoke to them about the Father. Now they must have thought, I speak to the world those things which I heard from him. They must have thought, which him is he talking about? You know, what, is it Joseph? Some things Joseph told him that he's coming and telling us. So it's, you know, it's like the blindness. The blindness which is there in the world, you know, that scriptures also talk about how Satan makes the hearts of the people unreceptive. The eyes, spiritual eyes, are blinded. So the truth is in front of them. Jesus is in front of them. He's speaking his truth to them, but they are not able to receive. And it's very sad. You know, sometimes I wonder if we were there when Jesus lived, you know, which category would we fall in? Would we be like those disciples who believed immediately? You know, they believe. Or would we be among those who are struggling? Is he a teacher? Is he a prophet? Is he a Messiah? Would we be in that category? Or, you know, would we be among the scribes and the Pharisees? We are receiving all the information we need, but they did not understand. Okay. And for us, maybe we don't understand how people can be so hard-hearted. Now let's move on. So Jesus sees their hard-heartedness, and
there's a drop in my connectivity. Anyway, I'll just continue. Let's finish that portion. So I was saying that Jesus responds and he says, when you lift up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he. Okay, so then you will know that I am he, and that I do nothing of myself, but as my Father taught me, I speak these things. And he who sent me is with me. The Father has not left me alone, for I always do those things that pleased him. As he spoke these words, many believed in him. So, now again, these claims, you see that Jesus is saying that I am from the Father. And he's also saying that there will come a time when you lift up the Son of Man. Son of Man is again, you know, a title that he is using for himself to describe that he is the Messiah. And he's saying that when the Son of Man is lifted up, then you will know that I am he. So what is he referring to? When the Son of Man is lifted up, you know, some people wonder whether this is about exalting Jesus, because when we praise him, when we worship, when we adore, you know, we are lifting up Jesus. So is that what he's saying? When we lift up Jesus, that one will come to know that he truly is the Son of God? But here, more specifically, he's referring to his crucifixion on the cross. You know, because on the cross, what would they do? They would crucify a person, and they would kind of, you know, make that cross stand, and also they would make a public spectacle, right, of that individual. So being lifted up in that sense, or being put out there publicly on display. So Jesus is referring to his very painful death on the cross, and he's saying, look, when I do that work that the Father has called me to do, then you will know that I am he. He meaning the Messiah, and that I do nothing of myself. Obviously, you know, that's a very difficult assignment which the Father has given him. So unless he is committed to the Father, you know, why would any human being agree to go through such a painful end? But only because his life was consecrated, only because his life was dedicated to God, you see that he is committed to that one assignment and task which the Father has mainly sent him here for. So he's saying, when I do that, that time you will understand that I am from the Father. And again, you know, the remaining things, we can talk about every small portion here for hours together, but I'm just trying to avoid that. You know, go back and meditate on these scriptures, because there's just so much Jesus is saying in these statements. In this passage, he's again trying to connect himself to the Father, and he's trying to reveal that he has a personal relationship with Jehovah God, which again is offensive for the Jews. They must have been very, very offended to listen to the way Jesus is identifying himself, because what question, you know, their latest question to Jesus, who are you? So he's saying, I'm the Messiah. I'm the son of the Father, and you have to believe in me. Okay, so with this, let's just take a break right now. We'll stop, we will come back, and we will continue from here. So 10 minutes. Yeah, it's 9:49. So how about we come back at let's come back at 11 o'clock. Okay, thank you.